what you will get out of it. يغفر لكم ذنوبكم. Allah will forgive you your sins. وَيُدْخِلْكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ. You know, if instead of this investment, you opt for another investment, you know, from where we did we begin? Quran, the guidance. And we found out that each one of us in this life has an achievement in his mind. And if you crystallize that achievement, that comes to be a mansion, a house, in a beautiful location with all the amenities in it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, come on. Invest in my business. Be my partners. I'll give you the best return. What is that? I'll give you, forgive you your sins. And I'll admit you to the gardens of perpetual residence. And the gardens under which rivers flow, you know, this tells the location. On the riverside, on the lakeside. Then, residential apartments surrounded by the gardens. And nevertheless, you will never be turned out of them. Perpetual rest. That is the great achievement. And another, the great and real achievement is the achievement of the hereafter. But another, lesser achievement. Lesser than that, secondary achievement can be tuhibbunaha, which by the way you love more. You know, it's one of the weak points of man that he wants immediate gain. So if you work in Allah's cause to make deen of Allah supreme, what you would like? That I should accomplish the goal tomorrow. As soon as possible. Or at least within my life. But to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is not the real achievement. The real achievement is, your goal should be to succeed in the hereafter. And the real success of the Akhira, basic success of the Akhira is you are forgiven. I simplify it like this. If Allah simply writes down on my file, forgiven, what does it want? That is the highest achievement. And then in addition, Allah admits into the gardens of eternity and provides me mansions to reside in and to enjoy in terms of food, relaxing, everything. That is in addition. But my narrow mind wants again right here. So Allah Almighty says that is secondary, ukhra, another. That should not be the goal. The goal should be the Akhirah. Mus'ab bin Ubay radiallahu anhu, who helped Medina to become the alternate base for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was shaheed at Uhud. Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was martyred at Uhud. Sumayya radiallahu ta'ala anha, she couldn't see. यासर रज़ियल्लाहु ताला अन्हु कुड नॉट सी इस्लाम डोमिनेटिंग. डू यू थिंक दे फेल? नेवर एवर. दे वर द मोस्ट सक्सेसफुल वंस बट दे डिड नॉट सी अल्लाह दीन डोमिनेटिंग. दो दे वर्क फॉर दैट कॉज. So the real achievement is the achievement in the hereafter. And if that is the goal, doesn't matter. You are able to move one step, two steps, three steps, or you are killed at the very first step, even then you are successful. Now, where you have to start? You need an organization. How to organize the people? You know, there are different types of organizations. One is an organization based on a common need. You live in a community and you're all facing common problems: drainage, water supply, security. Okay, you call a meeting of the community and you voice the problems and everybody says, yes, yes, it's a problem. Then you say, okay, let us make a society of the community to solve these problems. All the people say, yes, we are ready to contribute. Then you elect someone as your leader. One president, one secretary, one treasurer, this. But if you are calling for something absolutely new, then you don't have to wait for others. You have been, you know, the messenger has been given an assignment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or after the Prophet ﷺ, when Islam is again dominated by others, someone from you feels that he has to do this job. He will come and say, I am going to start this. Anyone who can help me. Now those who are convinced that yes, I should also join him, he will join. But he will not keep on waiting that, oh, some other people should come, then let us start. And then he looks for the figure, okay, how much people should be there when I should start? 10? No. It's too little number. 20? No. At least 50. But oh, the task is very high. 50 is not sufficient too. You will never feel satisfied that you have got a sufficient number to start. So, as far the messengers are concerned, they were duty bound from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They didn't wait for others. As Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, he had an assignment from Allah to spread Allah's deen and to do the reformative work among the sons of Israel. That was his assignment. What did he do? He didn't first got members of that organization and then started. No. He started giving sermons and then asked, who would help me in Allah's cause? So, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu, O believers, kunu ansar Allah. Be Allah's helpers. Be the helpers of Allah. Kama qala Isa ibn Maryam lil hawariyin. Just as Isa, son of Mary, salamun alayhima, said to his disciples, Man ansari ilallah, who are my helpers to work for Allah? Qala al hawariyun. the disciples responded, "Nahnu Ansarullah." We are Allah's helpers. What an expression, Allah's helpers. This is a very strange expression. We are Allah's helpers. No, Isa alayhi salam said, "Who are my helpers to work for Allah?" But the disciples said, "We are Allah's helpers." What does it mean? Allah doesn't need any help. But if you view, the problem is to restore Allah's rule on earth, and you are working for this cause, Allah Almighty treats you as His helpers out of His grace. But what actually is going to happen is the other way around. Allah Almighty says in the Quran, another place, "In tansurullah yansurku." And here also you saw, "Nasrum min Allah." If you help Allah, Allah will help you. So Allah, out of His grace, treats your effort as a help to Him. But in fact, if we work for Allah, Allah will help us to achieve the goal. قال الحواريون, the disciples responded, "نحن أنصار الله." We are Allah's helpers. فَآمَنَ الطَّائِفَةٌ مِّن بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. Thus a faction of the sons of Israel believed. وَكَفَرَ الطَّائِفَةٌ. But the others disbelieved. No, these others are the remaining Jews. Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam himself was a Jew. He was from sons of Israel, himself was a Jew. But he was given the assignment of reformation of deen among the Jews. So he started his job, he started criticizing the Jew scholars, Jew shuyukh, rabbis, and then people joined hands with him. So those who joined hand with him, they believed him as Allah's messenger. The others refused to believe. فَأَيَّدَنَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَىٰ عَدُوِّهِمْ. In the life of Isa alayhi salam, the number of those who joined him and believed in him as Allah's messenger was few. But later on, Allah Almighty helped them. Helped those who believed in Isa over those who were their enemies. And final result you yet can see was the number of Jews in the world and was the number of Christians in the world. Very obvious. فَأَيَّدْنَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَىٰ عَدُوِّهِمْ. However, we aided the believers against their enemies. فَأَصْبَحُوا ظَاهِرِينَ. So they became victorious. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also was assigned the mission, as we have read, that he has to make Allah's deen dominate the whole way of life. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also had disciples, which whom we call the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. Now the terms are different. Reality is the same. Disciples were the helpers of Isa alayhi salam in Allah's cause, and Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, were his helpers in Allah's cause. But they have been named as Hawariyin, and the Prophet's companions have been named as Sahaba. Ashabul Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa radiyallahu anhu. The question is, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accomplished the highest ever goal in this life. You know, he brought about a revolution. And we know many other revolutions too. French Revolution, Bolshevik Revolution. But if you analyze these revolutions, they made a prominent change only in one aspect of the collective human life. In French Revolution, there was only a change in the political system. Monarchy was replaced by democracy. That was the change only, nothing else. And in Bolshevik Revolution, Russian Revolution, the change was only in the economic system. A party replaced the feudal lords, the mill owners, and it was accepted that the rights of proprietorship should be limited only to articles of use, but the rest should be owned by the state. That was a new ideology which took over, which replaced feudalism. Whereas revolution brought by Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah's messenger, was a complete revolution. You have to look for anything which didn't change. Their beliefs changed. Their ideologies altered. Their thinking altogether changed. Their economic system changed. Political system changed. Those who wanted to live now wanted to die for Allah. Now, something which yet is something unmanageable for the West. No one's a British Prime Minister. There was the Madrid bombing, if you remember, in 2003 or 4. The British Prime Minister was asked the problem. He said, the problem is we want to live, they want to die. You know, an Urdu poet from India, Altaf Hussain Hali, rahimahullah, he beautifully portrayed that those who used to fight for water, that I'll take water first, and for this tiny reason they used to kill each other. What happened to them? In the battle of Qadsiya, Muslims were fighting, and one Muslim Mujahid was injured. There was too much bleeding. He felt thirsty, he asked for water. And the man with water rushed to him. He was to serve him water. Another Mujahid asked for water. He said, no, give first to him. When the water supplier approached him, the third injured person asked for water. He said, no, first give it to him. When he reached him, the fourth one asked for water. He said, no, give him water first. And when the man with water reached him, he had passed away. He rushed to the third, he had passed away. He rushed to the second, he had passed away. And to the first, he had passed away. What a change. Those who wanted to live, you know, Quran describes the nature of Quraysh.
yawaddu ahadum law yu'ammaru alf sana.
They are so much greedy of the worldly life that each one of us wants to live for 1,000 years. What happened to them? They want to die now. What injection Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave them? What change he brought to them? How did he accomplish this goal? The same poet Hali describes, utar kar Hira se suye qaum aaya aur ek nuskhay kimya saath laya, mise kham ko jisne kundan banaya, khara aur khota alag kar dikhaya, arab jiske kadmon se tha jahl chhaya, palatti basi kaan mein uski kaya, idhar se udhar phir gaya rukhawa ka, rahadar ne bede ko mauje bala ka, idhar se udhar phir gaya rukhawa ka. He says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam descended from Hira with a chemical recipe in his hand, the Quran, who was administered and injected to the Bedouins of Arab, to those who used to fight for the water, those who wanted to live, and it altogether changed them. Everything changed. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam accomplished this goal through the Quran. Inshallah, in the next session, we'll study Surah Al-Jumu'ah, which tells us about how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam purified them. You know, self-purification is a very important subject. It is a goal in front of a good number of shuyukh of our time too. But let us see how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam accomplished this goal. How did he purify his companions? Inshallah, we'll study after the Shaykh's talk. He's there, our guest speaker today. Inshallah, we'll study after he delivers his presentation. آخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.